Thank you. graciously keep from us all adversity, so that, unhindered in mind and body alike, we may pursue in freedom of heart the things that are yours. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
She left to get it, and he called after her, "Please bring along a bit of bread." She answered, "As the Lord, your God, lives, I have nothing baked. There is only a handful of flour in my jar and a little oil in my jug. Just now, I was collecting a couple of sticks to go in and prepare something for myself and my son. When we have eaten it, we shall die." Elijah said to her, "Do not be afraid. Go and do as you propose. But first, make me a little cake and bring it to me. Then you can prepare something for yourself and your son. For the Lord, the God of Israel, says, 'The jar of flour shall not go empty, nor the jug of oil run dry, until the day when the Lord sends rain upon the earth.'" She left and did as Elijah had said. She was able to eat for a year, and he and her son as well. The jar of flour did not go empty, nor the jug of oil run dry, as the Lord had foretold through Elijah. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
reading from the letter to the Hebrews. Christ did not enter into a sanctuary made by hands, a copy of the true one, but heaven itself, that he might now appear before God on our behalf. Not that he might offer himself repeatedly, as the high priest enters each year into the sanctuary with blood that is not his own. If that were so, he would have had to suffer repeatedly from the foundation of the world. But now, for all, he has appeared at the end of the ages to take away sin by his sacrifice. Just as it is appointed that human beings die once, and after this, the judgment, so also Christ offered once to take away the sins of many, will appear a second time, not to take away sin, but to bring salvation to those who eagerly await him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Care of all her needs. In our responsorial song today from Psalm 146, we hear the words, "The Lord sustains the orphan and the widow." And of course, there's the supposition that the orphan and the widow trust in the Lord and that they avoid ways that are evil and lead to sin. And in the gospel today from St. Mark chapter 12, Jesus warns the scribes and other religious figures who devour the houses of widows and as a pretext recite earthly prayers. Okay, I'm wearing rather long robes today. Have I ever visited the home of a widow? Sure I have. But I assure you, I do not devour their savings, nor do I recite extremely lengthy prayers when I go to their house. Okay. Jesus assures that religious people who abuse their authority, who are in this for themselves, will receive a severe, severe punishment. And then in the gospel today, Jesus tells us the parable of the poor widow who put her last two coins into the treasury of the temple. She is poor, yet she wants to give something great to God because she knows God's goodness to her. And I have seen many times in my life and in my ministry, people who are poor, who are incredibly generous, especially when there is a need. I've had in the past situations where somebody's house is caught on fire, or maybe somebody dies and there's not enough money in the family for a funeral. We've had special collections, and I see sometimes people who are really poor themselves will pour out their hearts in a situation like that and give so much more than would be expected. And likewise, I've seen people be very generous to sister parishes that, like a Perpetual Help, and in my previous parish, we had a sister parish that we adopted in Haiti. I see people give beyond their means in order to serve people who are poorer than themselves. Now, at the foundation of the attitude of the poor widow who helped Elijah and the poor widow who gave her last two coins in the temple, at the foundation of this attitude was trust in God and in his providence and in his ability to take care of us. These two women had complete trust that God would be true to his word and would provide for them, and the Lord and would provide all that they need. They wouldn't become rich, but he would provide all that they need. And the Lord is calling us have the same level of trust in him with our finances and with every other aspect of our lives. If we give to God with generosity, if we make the tithe to God a goal for ourselves, as the Bible instructs us to do, and if we give our time and our talents to God, to his church, to our community with generosity, then he will be faithful to his word. He will bless us, and he indeed will protect us and give us all that we need. Returning for a moment to the warning that Jesus has for widows, or in reality to any person who may be vulnerable to religious people who rob and steal, we've all probably heard stories of evangelists and pastors who insist that members of their congregation give the tithe or even more to a church or to a ministry. And then they live themselves like kings with expensive cars and big mansions and fur coats and the whole nine yards, while members of their congregation or their ministry live in poverty. We have to be wise. We have to use the intelligence that God gave us, and we also have to demand, on account of the ways that our donations are being used by our church or by other charities that we support, we have to demand transparency by the church and by any charity. Now, returning to the theme of trusting God, I want to emphasize something that's in our second reading today, in the letter to the Hebrews, chapter 9. Christ Jesus paid the price for the forgiveness of our sins only one time. He does not die over and over again. Yes, we call it the sacrifice of the Mass because the one sacrifice of Jesus that happened in human time becomes present to us again and again and again, so we can have the fruit of that sacrifice. But Jesus does not die again and again and again. And likewise, we only have one life to live. Listen to these words from the author of Hebrews in today's second reading. He says, just as it is appointed that human beings die once, and after this the judgment, so also Christ offered once to take away the sins of many. So scripture is very clear. We die once, which means we only live once. And that means there's no reincarnation. Many people today, even Christian people, entertain thoughts that there is reincarnation. If we don't get it right this time, we can come back as another person, or as an animal, or as a tree, or as a flower, or whatever, and get it right. And now, scripture is very clear. This is our opportunity to be right with God, and to live for Him, and to put the needs of others before ourselves. This is the only life that we have to choose Christ as our Lord and Savior. So my brothers and sisters, let's trust in Him with every aspect of our lives, because He loves us more than we can ever, ever imagine. He will always provide us with all that we need, including eternal life, if we trust in Him. My brothers and sisters, I want to turn over the microphone for a few minutes to Peggy Hall. She's our cantor today, and she's also the president of our finance committee here in the parish. She's going to give you an update on our situation financially here in the parish. And also, you'll see in your bulletin, there's a financial report for the fiscal year that ended this past June 30th, and there's a pie chart explaining how we've been using your donations and our expenses.
Groaning just a little bit right now, and I don't blame you. But I promise to be brief, and all I'm going to ask you to do is listen for a couple minutes and then spend a little time thinking this week. As Father Rich said, in today's bulletin there's a parish financial report, and it shows that despite COVID-19, our parish was able to pay all bills and end the year with a surplus, which is really good news, and we are grateful to you for that. Our Lady of Sorrows runs a pretty lean operation. We have a small staff who work incredibly hard for modest compensation. Our facilities are not lavish, but our sanctuary is beautiful, and our buildings and grounds are maintained and improved as needed and appropriate. Those two areas comprise the bulk of our expenses. Not surprisingly, more than 80% of our income comes from regular Sunday offerings, and your continued support through COVID and a very challenging time brought us to that surplus at the end of the year, and we really are truly grateful. Now, my experience is that is all most people want to know from a financial report. Bills got paid and there's money left over. If you would like to dig into the details, then you're kind of right in my little bailiwick, and I would be happy to talk with you about that, but most people don't want to do that, so I'm not going to spend time on that now. But what I am going to ask you now is I want you to think about our parish, your parish. My husband and I moved to Our Lady of Sorrows as newlyweds in 1983 and joined the parish. I got involved in the music ministry back when there was a folk group, which some people in this room don't even know what that is. John was the Eucharistic minister and collection counter, Monsignor Duke retired and Father Smith came. Father Smith baptized our son in 1988 at that font. This community offered love and compassion when I miscarried. And then Father Smith baptized our daughter in 1991. And God bless the volunteers who ran the Sunday morning nursery during those days. Next came First Communions and Sacrament Reconciliation. Our children went to CCD classes here with their school classmates, and that intertwined their faith journey with their secular path. The kids were altar servers and members of the children's choir, learning that they have responsibilities to support their parish. We've had our share of ham and chicken dinners and Shrove Tuesday pancakes. We've served on different parish committees, liturgy, finance, building and grounds, parish council. Over the years, there have been countless Christmas parties for children and adults, May crownings, Bible studies in small groups, vacation Bible school sessions, funerals, but also weddings, parish ministries, parish missions, and guest speakers. 10th grade confirmation prep gave us the chance to start the grown-up conversations with our kids about what it means to be an adult in the Catholic Church. We've shared beautiful Advent, Christmas, Lenten, and Easter liturgies. Father Mark gave our son his first paying job as a Sunday morning sacristan. We've helped fill baskets at Thanksgiving and Christmas. We've been on a hayride or two at parish picnics. And our daughter and son-in-law married here in 2017. We've tried to support Father Tim and now Father Rich as they brought our pastorate into a reality while also figuring out how to worship in quarantine. I've cried, I've celebrated. Sometimes I might sit back and shake my head. But through it all, for 38 years, this parish and its people have provided for my spiritual life. You've shared my prayers, and I've had the privilege and honor of praying for you and your intentions. I hope your experiences are similar to mine. Maybe they're completely different. Maybe you look at our parish and you see things that you would like added. I know over the years I have. We have wonderful volunteers, but even with their support, parish programs cost money. Can you help us make that happen? Remember that 80% of our income comes from Sunday offerings. If you're a numbers person, guilty, you may know what percentage of your take-home pay you're currently contributing. Would you think about increasing that? Maybe 0.5% this year, maybe 0.5% next year, or more? If your giving is a little less structured, would you think about adding a little more each week? Could you give $5 more? If you're in a position to make a larger increase, all the better. But most of us aren't in that position. I ask you to please think about what Mother Teresa said, that we can do small things with great love. And if we all do that, we can make a difference. Please give this some thought, and thank you for listening.
Thank you. Just to encapsulate, next weekend, we will be having a commitment weekend where we will have commitment cards, and we will ask you to give us a commitment for the following year as to what you can contribute to the parish or what percentage of your income you're willing to give to our parish so that we can plan next year's budget and assure that we have all that we need to cover our salaries, to cover our other expenses that come up. We do have aging buildings that have things go wrong and we have to pay for it. And of course, the cost of all of that has gone up. So please, I ask you to be as generous as possible next weekend when you think about, and please pray and discern this coming week how you can give to this parish. Thank you so much. Let us now stand as we profess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible, begotten of God, made consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and life of the world to come. Amen.
It is the Lord who raises up the lowly. Let us bring our needs before the God of the widow and orphan. Our response to each petition is, Lord, hear our prayer.
That the church will be characterized by humility and authenticity in responding to the gospel. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That political and economic leaders will make a greater effort to share the nation's goods more equitably. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those in our local community who work to feed the poor and hungry will be supported generously. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those who have died may enter eternal life. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our military, law enforcement, and emergency personnel who risk their lives in the service of our nation, that they might be protected from evil and harm. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those who are sick, including those listed in our bulletin, and the Grover family and Kathy Gartley, will receive comfort and strength from those around them. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the intentions we hold in our hearts, and especially for Nancy Winterberg and Joyce Talbert, for whom this Mass is offered. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for the needs of the poor throughout the world and locally as well. We also pray for the respect and protection of all life, from conception to natural death, and for our seminaries in the Archdiocese and for a continuous increase in vocations. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Loving Father, you provide for those who respond to you in faith. Hear our prayers, which we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Please join me in our offertory hymn number 627 in the Gathered Book, You Are Mine, number 627.
offer you, fruit of the earth and work of human hands. It will become for us the bread of life.
Blessed be God.
By the mystery of this water and wine, may we come to share in the divinity of Christ, who humbled himself to share in our humanity. Blessed are you, Lord, God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the wine we offer you, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It will become our spiritual drink.
Blessed be God forever.
With humble spirit and contrite heart, may we be accepted by you, O Lord, and may our sacrifice in your sight this day be pleasing to you, Lord God. Lord, wash away my iniquity, cleanse me of all my sin. Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands, with the praise and glory of his name, for our good and good of all his holy church.
Look with favor, we pray, O Lord, upon the sacrificial gifts offered here, that celebrating in mystery the passion of your Son, we may honor it with loving devotion. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit,
lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, for you so loved the world that in your mercy you sent us the Redeemer, to live like us in all things but sin, so that you might love in us what you loved in your Son, by whose obedience we have been restored to those gifts of yours that by sinning we had lost in disobedience. And so, Lord, with all the angels and saints, we too give you thanks, as in exaltation we acclaim. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." mystery of faith. Partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and William, our Archbishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. In accordance with your will. Live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
Peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other a sign of Christ's peace.
Thank you.
called the Supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed.
Please join in our communion hymn number 578 in the Gather Book. We remember 578.
Thank you.
We have ministers of the Eucharist taking communion to the homebound or the sick today. Lord Jesus, we ask you to bless Joyce as she takes communion to the sick today. And whomever receives at her hand, may that person be healed in body, mind, and soul, and be united to us as one body and to you as one body. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Thanksgiving and Christmas food baskets is underway. Please bring in non-perishable items and or contribute to the poor fund for the fresh food items that we have to purchase. Sign up sheets for helpers to make the baskets and for gift shoppers to shop for the things that go in the baskets. Sign up sheets are at both entrances of the church. Preparation information about when and how to prepare the baskets will be given out next weekend. Our next baptism class for parents and godparents who are planning to have a child baptized soon, our next class is tomorrow at 7 p.m. in the parish hall. Listening sessions for you as members of our pastorate and town hall meetings to discuss questions pertinent to the worldwide synod called by Pope Francis will be held on the following dates. This is your opportunity to talk about the mission and direction of our worldwide church. Next Sunday, we have one here at 11:45 here at Our Lady of Sorrows. On Wednesday the 17th, we have one at 7 p.m. at Our Lady of Perpetual Help. And on Thursday the 18th, we have a Spanish language session at Our Lady of Perpetual Help. Vamos a tener en español en Nuestra Señora de Perpetuo Socorro el 18 de noviembre para el cine, para los que hablan en español. That's it. Let us pray. Nourished by this sacred gift, O Lord, we give you thanks and beseech your mercy, that by the pouring forth of your Spirit, the grace of integrity may endure in those your heavenly power has entered. Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Mass is ended. Let us go forth in peace, glorifying God with our lives. Thanks be to God.
Please join me in closing on number 603 in the Gather Book. There's a wideness in God's mercy. Number 603.